Welcome to Muscle Tissue, Part 1. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, and I'm the Histology Wizard. This tutorial will cover the basic characteristics of all muscle and discuss the organization of skeletal muscle in more detail. Now, recall from embryology that all muscle cells are derived from mesoderm. These cells are called variously myofibers, muscle cells, or muscle fibers, but they all refer to the single muscle cell. There are three subtypes of muscle tissue: skeletal, cardiac, and smooth muscle. These subtypes all share some general characteristics. For example, they're all longer than they are wide. They all contain myofilaments composed of actin, myosin, and accessory proteins. They all contract, and each of them uses ATP hydrolysis to drive that contraction. Now, the mechanisms and the control of contraction actually differ among the three types, but we'll cover that in our second muscle tutorial. There are two types of striated muscle: skeletal muscle, which is found in our skeletal muscles in the tongue, parts of the eye, and part of the esophagus, and cardiac muscle, which is found only in the heart. Now, you can note in these two upper sections and in the cartoons that the muscle actually looks striped or striated, and you can see these striations under the light microscope. Smooth muscle, in contrast, is not striated, and it's found in the digestive system, the respiratory tract, and in blood vessels. Skeletal muscle has to have strong, quick contractions, and these contractions are, of course, voluntary. So the organization of this muscle type is going to reflect those functional requirements. Similarly, cardiac muscle has strong, quick contractions, but these contractions, of course, are continuous and they're involuntary. Finally, smooth muscle contractions are much weaker and much slower. Now, like cardiac tissue, these contractions are involuntary, but the control of those contractions is different. You can note the size differences of the muscle cells in the bottom diagram and see that skeletal muscle cells are much, much larger than the other two types. We're now going to move on and discuss the organization of skeletal muscle in more detail, remembering that its structure will reflect its functions. So a skeletal muscle is critical for most of our behavior. It helps us with our posture and gives us our ability to draw breath. Because of its high energy requirements, skeletal muscle is a major metabolic consumer, but also stores vast amounts of energy. And along with movement, skeletal muscle plays a major role in controlling serum glucose concentration, which we'll explore later in our unit. In part due to these functions, skeletal muscle has some regenerative capacity. So, for example, if we inject myotoxin, by about 5 days, these injected dead cells will begin to regenerate. And by 10 days, muscle cells have fully regenerated. And with the caveat that this regeneration does not always reflect the original organization, and that this capacity actually decreases with age. Skeletal muscle is highly organized, and part of that organization is controlled by connective tissue sheaths or layers that surround first the individual muscle fibers. This layer is called the endomysium, and you can remember that it's closest again to that single muscle fiber. A bunch of muscle fibers are then arranged or bundled into fascicles, and each fascicle is surrounded by the perimysium, a layer of dense irregular connective tissue. And this layer is actually derived from the outermost layer, or epimysium, which is a much thicker layer of dense irregular connective tissue. These sheaths tend to blend and interdigitate at the end of muscles, and they become continuous with the tendons, or dense regular connective tissue, and we call this a myotendinous junction. Now, all of these layers or sheaths serve to protect the muscle fibers, but the perimysium and epimysium also contain blood vessels and nerves, and they use those sheaths to reach the interior of the muscle. And capillaries form a network around individual muscle cells. And again, this is important because of the large consumption of oxygen. Another characteristic of skeletal muscle is its multinucleate nature. During embryonic development, these cells are formed by the fusion of myoblasts that produce a postmitotic multinucleated myotube, which then further matures into a long muscle cell that can reach up to several centimeters long. This entire process is controlled by a vast gene network that you don't have to memorize, and mutations in these genes affect muscle development, so they can affect muscle type, cell size, and also cell number. Now, you can also see in this diagram a satellite cell, which is a shorter, unfused myoblast cell that retains the ability to divide. So this is the stem cell of the muscle cell. And these cells, of course, are responsible for repair and regeneration. Now let's take a look at what skeletal muscle looks like under the microscope. Recall that each myofiber is going to be surrounded by that endomysium sheath, which in this cross-section outlines each pentagonal-shaped fiber. It's important to pay attention to the location of nuclei in all muscle tissue, But in skeletal muscle, the multiple nuclei can be found around the periphery of the cell, and they almost look as though they're outside the cell. In this cartoon, you can see skeletal muscle in cross-section again, but here you can see both the perimysium surrounding a fascicle and the endomysium surrounding the individual muscle fiber. Now here's a section of skeletal muscle in longitudinal section, where I've outlined one muscle fiber. Again, note that the nuclei look almost as if they are between the fibers. In this cross-section, we can see satellite cells. Now, normally with our sections in histology lab, we don't see satellite cells because they require special staining techniques. But here you can see them outlined. And these cells reside under the basal lamina of the muscle cells and, again, are important for repair and regeneration. Now let's go back to organization. We're going to review a little bit, going from the outside of a muscle in. In the top cartoon, you can see the epimysium surrounding the muscle fascicles. And next, we see that perimysium surrounding each fascicle that contains myofibers. Endomysium surrounds each muscle fiber, and each fiber contains longitudinally arranged myofibrils. Now we'll take a little closer look at the organization of the myofibrils, as they are the basis for striated muscle function, both skeletal and cardiac muscle. Myofibrils consist of repeats of sarcomere units. They are composed of actin and myosin-containing filaments and many accessory proteins. And the sarcomeres are the contractile unit of striated muscle. So let's take a muscle cell and slice it sagittally. So we're going to remove one side so that you can see the alignment of many myofibrils, which take up about 80% of the cytoplasm, and those are marked here with the blue arrows. Again, these are going to be arranged by repeating sarcomere units, and we're going to discuss the organization of sarcomere units in a couple of minutes. Surrounding the entire cell is the plasma membrane, and in the muscle cell, this is called the sarcolemma, and it's surrounded by basal lamina and, again, those satellite cells. So unfortunately, this is one of those cases in science and medicine where the parts of the cell have different names than you've probably learned in other classes. The sarcolemma is going to project long finger-like projections that are called transverse tubules, or T-tubules, deep into the cytoplasm, or the sarcoplasm, of the cell. And these make contact with membranous sacs or channels called the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This reticulum or network contains high concentrations of calcium that are important for the control of muscle contraction. The place where the sarcoplasmic reticulum sacs join to the T-tubules is called a triad, and that's named after the two sacs of the sarcoplasmic reticulum plus one tubule. You can see an example of the many nuclei located at the periphery of the cell here in blue. And note that large numbers of mitochondria surround the myofibrils. So again, these mitochondria are important due to the large energy demands of the muscle cells. Next, let's dig into the general organization of the sarcomere. So this is something you need to understand in order to really understand muscle contraction, to understand the basis of many muscle pathologies, but of course, this is also highly testable on the boards. Sarcomere repeats here are represented by the myofibrils in the sarcoplasm of skeletal and cardiac muscle. And those myofibrils are composed of two major filaments formed by contractile proteins. The thick filaments contain myosin, while the thin filaments contain actin. These two filaments interact and generate the contractile force. Now, the arrangement of myosin and actin myofilaments of the sarcomere is responsible for this banding pattern that we see under the microscope. So here on the top, you can see skeletal muscle under the light microscope, while below you see an image under the electron microscope. Now, these banding patterns have been given different names, and we're going to walk through these in the next slide. I'll also be talking about a number of different proteins that hold the adjacent myofibrils together, including the intermediate filament proteins vimentin and desmin. All right, here's a pretty simplified cartoon of the myofibril. You can note the hexagon arrays and the Z discs, which contain proteins including alpha actinin. And this is the insertion point for the thin filaments. Note that one sarcomere is defined from Z disc to Z disc. A contraction then involves the sarcomere shortening, but the actual filament lengths do not change. We're going to talk a lot in the next tutorial about control of contraction, but I just want you to note here that it's controlled by calcium, and that control is based on thin filament proteins. Now let's review the various lines and bands of the sarcomere. The thin filaments attach at the Z-discs, and again, the major protein component here is alpha-actinin. The I-band is formed solely by the thin filaments and their associated proteins, while the A band is formed by the thick filaments, or the myosin filaments. This A band is bisected by another band that's called the H band, so this is a lighter region, and its major component is creatine kinase, and this is the enzyme that catalyzes the formation of ATP, again, critical for contraction. The M band, or line, also contains the creatine kinase, but the actual line is formed by bridges and filaments that connect the thick filaments together, as you can see in this cross section below. When reviewing this information, you should try and think about what would happen to the lengths of the different bands upon contraction, and remember that the lengths of the filaments themselves do not change. Here we can see a cross-sectional view of the hexagonal arrangement. You can see the six thin filaments surrounding each thick filament shown by the green dot. Also critical to note here are the presence of these accessory proteins that help organize the assembly. And these proteins are what help maintain the integrity of the myofibril. They form a network around that Z-disc. These proteins are often enormous proteins, such as nebulin, which helps to keep the actin filaments aligned, and titin, that acts as a tunable spring. So this protein actually senses force, provides elasticity and stability to the filaments. Now, there are a large number of other proteins that are shown in this cartoon, and you don't need to know the names of these. But you should remember that mutations in these proteins can lead to unstable myofibrils, aberrant function, and thus myopathies or muscle diseases where the muscles don't function properly. Ultimately, the question is the force generated by these myofilaments transferred to the outside of the cell? So the entire myofibril assembly has to be connected to the sarcolemma because the force of the contraction has to be transmitted. And this happens through attachment of actin filaments and via these Z-discs to a large complex of proteins. And we're going to briefly talk about these proteins. Again, this complex includes a large number of proteins, but the one I want you to remember is dystrophin. And dystrophin is essentially a very large bridge protein which links actin to the protein complex of the sarcolemma. And here I've circled it in orange. Loss of dystrophin leads to the most common form of muscular dystrophy, which is called Duchenne muscular dystrophy, which is a progressive muscle myopathy. In general, any defect that impairs proteins in this large complex can destabilize the architecture of the sarcolemma. And how impaired the muscles are, or which muscles are affected, depends somewhat upon what protein is affected and whether that protein is actually defective, whether it's reduced, or whether it's missing entirely. Now, to make this a lot more complex, as this schematic shows, the membrane destabilization is somewhat balanced by the ability of skeletal muscle to regenerate or repair due to the presence of those satellite or stem cells we talked about earlier. In healthy muscles, physiological damage occurs all the time, such as micro-tearing caused by exercise or damage from mild contusions to the muscle. And this actually stimulates the stem cells, and so the muscle is able to repair and the membrane can retain integrity. However, if the repair processes are inadequate, or stem cells are defective or missing, or there are mutations such as in dystrophin that we just talked about, or maybe both, this leads to destabilization of the sarcolemma and connections to myofibrillar units, and that results in muscle cell tearing, loss of function, death, and eventual replacement of muscle fibers with connective tissue and fat. So to recap, other than dystrophin, you don't need to know the names of the protein in the sarcolemma complex, but you should know where they are located in the cell, and you should be able to predict what might happen to muscle cells over time if these proteins are defective or missing. Secondly, you should be able to extrapolate to what this might look like under the microscope. I'll leave you with this brief summary of skeletal muscle organization. And in the next tutorial, we'll briefly review specific features of cardiac and smooth muscle, including how to tell them apart under the microscope. But the bulk of our time will be spent on understanding the process of muscle contraction.